In 1988, Isaac Asimov predicted that we would all own computers connected to massive libraries and be able to access digital teachers and reference materials on demand, allowing us to learn at our own pace, wherever we want, about whatever we choose. So, basically, this. You know what's frustrating about tomorrow? That it's not today. And that makes it very hard to predict. But that doesn't stop us from trying. And lots of our predictions about the science of tomorrow come in the form of science fiction. Science is for the most part a historical study. It's built on observations of things that have already happened. But science fiction has a decidedly tomorrow-y bent to it.
Where have you been? I've beamed and beamed.
Not all predictions are correct, of course. I mean, you'd have to be a pretty big bojo to think that we're actually going to have hoverboards by October 21st, 2015.
Hey, McFly, you bojo! The boats don't work on water!
But throughout the history of science fiction, people have got a lot of things amazingly right. Like in 1865, Jules Verne predicted the US would send 3 men to the moon in a spaceship named Columbiad, launched on a rocket weighing 20,000 pounds at a cost of $12.1 billion. Now, 104 years later, the US sent 3 men to the moon in a spaceship named Columbia on a rocket weighing 26,000 pounds at a cost of $14.4 billion. Not bad. Mark Twain, in his 1898 story from the London Times of 1904, predicted a worldwide network of interconnected telephone devices that would let people share information, and he even predicted that we would just waste time looking at what everyone else was doing. He wasn't the only one to predict the internet. Douglas Adams wrote about a handheld device that was the standard repository for all knowledge and wisdom in the galaxy. But that was in 1979, and the internet was already being built, so I don't know if it counts. But hey, you can read books on it. Arthur C. Clarke is also on the list of people who predicted internet-type computer things.
A console through which he can talk to his friendly local computer and get all the information he needs for his everyday life, like his bank statements, his theater reservations. This will be in a compact form in his own house. He'll have a television screen like these here and a keyboard, and he'll take it as much for granted as we take the telephone.
But his books got so many things right that you'd think he had access to some sort of superior form of artificial intelligence. Siri, can you open the pod bay doors, please?
That's a rather insensitive thing to say to an intelligent agent.
Today, artificial intelligence has advanced enough to win at Jeopardy, but so far, no one has died from it, I think. Before Arthur C. Clarke wrote stories, he worked on a radar for the Royal Air Force. In 1945, he wrote an article describing extraterrestrial relays, which essentially predicted and laid out a plan for our entire modern system of geostationary communication satellites. And to this day, that particular altitude of space that those satellites live is known as the Clarke orbit. In the 1911 story Ralph 124C41+, Hugo Gernsback, the namesake of science fiction's annual Hugo Awards, predicted that an emitted radio wave should reflect off distant objects and make them detectable, like visible light. Now that's something that we call radar, but it wasn't invented until almost 25 years later. In 1961's Stranger in a Strange Land, Robert Heinlein predicted screensavers, although I'm not sure he knew we'd use flying toasters. In Fahrenheit 451, Ray Bradbury predicted not only flat screen television, but also seashells and thimble radios worn in the ears, which I think we've all heard of. 50 years ago, during the 1964 World's Fair, Isaac Asimov predicted that in 2014, we would have some robots, but they wouldn't be very good yet. And that nuclear and solar power would replace fossil fuels. We'd have self-driving cars, unmanned missions to Mars, and that everyone would wear killer sideburns and bolo ties. Philip K. Dick is a decidedly more pessimistic predictor of the future, but he too was often right. Maybe it's not all sunshine and roses out there. Minority Report's precogs have been related by some to modern efforts to use neuroscience in the courtroom, and total recall level memory implantation is nowhere close to being real, but experiments in mice suggest that brain-to-brain neural linkage is not complete fiction. Do Android's Dream of Electric Sheep predicts a world full of bio-inspired engineering and human-like artificial intelligence? And in A Scanner Darkly, he predicted a level of high-tech government surveillance that I think we wish wasn't fiction. But I love the NSA.
The NSA is my friend.
But nobody, nobody holds a Nostradamus-y candle to H.G. Wells. He too predicted the iPad, oh, and automatic sliding doors, in 1899's When the Sleeper Wakes. He predicted the atomic bomb in scary detail, including all of the radioactive fallout horror that it would bring in 1914's The World Set Free. I mean, even down to some of the nuclear physics involved. He even called it the atomic bomb, which is not a term that even existed before that. The Shape of Things to Come predicted airborne warfare. Men like God saw wireless communications. War of the Worlds, spoilers, reminded us that faced with man or even alien technology, bacteria will always win. The Invisible Man used light refracting metamaterials for invisibility nearly a century before we even knew what metamaterials were. In The Island of Dr. Moreau, he not only predicted genetic engineering, but also asked a question that we still haven't quite answered. How does man safely manipulate nature when he too is part of nature? H.G. Wells was so good and so often correct about predicting the future that he's called the man who invented tomorrow, or today. Of course, not all sci-fi is good at predicting the future, and sci-fi gets a lot of stuff wrong, but you have to admit that some of these predictions are so spot on that you'd almost expect one of the authors to be from Gallifrey. One right prediction in any one body of work would be lucky, but this many right answers can't be luck. Clearly something sets these people apart. Now, many of the greatest sci-fi writers also had serious scientific training. Isaac Asimov had a PhD in biochemistry, and Arthur C. Clarke had degrees in math and physics, and H.G. Wells had a degree in biology. Of course, it also helps to hang out with people like Carl Sagan. At its core, good science fiction must rest on good science. Now, this seems obvious, but this, I think, is why the best sci-fi authors are also the most frequently right when it comes to predicting the future. How far can we see into the future? Well, it depends on what we're looking for. Isaac Asimov said that when we look at stars or galaxies or DNA, we're looking at simple things, things that follow nice, neat rules and equations. But when we look at human history, it's chaotic, unpredictable. Our vision is limited. Science transforms the complex into the simple. That's how we explain the chaos. Science is how we see farther, and science fiction is where we write down what we see. I want to know what you think down in the comments. What makes some science fiction so good at predicting the future? And I predict that I missed a ton of awesome science fiction that has become reality. So leave me your favorites down below and tell me what I missed. Stay curious.
Orson's War of the Worlds was based on another Wells' War of the Worlds, the 1897 novel by H.G. Wells. No relation, different spelling. H.G.'s war didn't take place in the Dirty Jurs, but rather in Surrey and London, in a very similar situation where humanity had very good reason to fear for its well-being at the hands of giant, laser-wielding not-friendlies.
Kissing is weird. We love doing it, but let's face it, it's weird. You're rubbing your open mouth on another human being's open mouth. So there must be a good reason that we do it.